57talk.com. Gary Cubetta back with you again, taping from Scottsdale, Arizona, and it's my pleasure to introduce legendary wrestler and manager, Skandor Akbar. Skandor, pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you for having me, Gary.
Skandor, you were very involved with the days of world-class championship wrestling from Texas, Fritz Von Erich, the Von Erich boys. When did you first get involved with Fritz?
Well, of course, getting involved with Fritz was in the 60s, and I started in 1962. And in 1966, when Fritz was, so to speak, he and Ed McLemore had broken away from the Houston office, and I worked several matches with these guys down here on Monday, Tuesdays, and Wednesdays. And that was in 1966. Then I had a couple of other tenures with them in the early 70s, and bear in mind that was NWA at that time. And World Class, of course, his inception was in the early 80s with a name.
Were you with World Class from day one?
No, I was not. I was not. However, I was fortunate to get into World Class after everything was really going good. And I might add that this organization reached epic proportions as far as drawing, and it was just literally on fire as people that watched World Class Wrestling. I mean, it was addictive to them, and the ratings just jumped completely out, and it was in the early 80s when I came here. Now, I want to add that I was working along with Mid-South at that time, and I started working both organizations. So I was hopping around with the great organization, Devastation Incorporated. And, of course, it was a lucrative area for a lucrative era, for myself and everybody that was in World Class and associated with that organization.
Skandor, what was it about World Class Wrestling when you arrived? Because you'd worked with Fritz before, you'd worked in a lot of other territories. What was special about it?
Well, what I think is it was a little different to the atmosphere as far as that goes. You know, Dallas and Fort Worth and Texas was always a good territory. But I think when the kids came along, it was kind of like they reached out a little bit further, and the younger people started the classic viewing, and I always it was like they were the franchise when things got going good, you know, and it was at the point where if one Von Erich would miss due to whatever, you would stick another Von Erich in the show, and nobody would object to that because they were the franchise. And, you know, I had the big dragons with me, and, you know, and they were supposedly the dragon slayers. So it was, like I said, it was unique in its own way, and it's hard to fathom that any other organization, maybe Mid-South, would have the equality of the drawing, and the people still remember. Each day that I get around this area, people recognize me, and they always ask me about World Class and when the wrestling business is going to get back like it used to be. So I'm not getting off on a tangent. I hope not, but this is the way that World Class was. It was an organization where if somebody came in and it was on fire, all you would do is just reap the rewards. And there was everybody was over, so to speak. And
who'd you bring in when you first came in?
When I first came in, I brought Kamala with me. Actually, Bundy was with me for a while. And I had Gene Lewis, who was Cousin Lewis for a while, and he had a little different moniker there, a little bit different, and but Kamala was the first big gun that I had, and then the rest of it.
Kamala at that time was money in the bank, right?
Yes. We were doing tremendous over at Mid-South.
So how'd Fritz approach you? Hey, come on in, Skandor. Bring Kamala.
Yeah. Well, here's the thing. Ken Mantell, who I had done a lot with over in Mid-South, and even before it was Mid-South, going back to the NWA days before the big name change and the split, and Kenny had taken over as the booker here in Dallas. And you know, it was a great opportunity for me, and so we set up between the two territories, and if I would make an interview for New Orleans, so to speak, like that, and I couldn't be there with Kamala, of course Friday would be there, but you know, it was a lucrative payday for me in both spots, maybe if I was in Fort Worth. So Kamala was the first big gun, and then we followed suit. You know, I had Killer Khan, I had the Missing Link, I had the Super D's, who was an excellent tag team match.
Who were they?
They were the Irwin brothers, the late and great Scott Irwin. God rest his soul. He was a very close friend of mine, and Bill Irwin.
How would you compare Scott Irwin, let's say, to a Bruiser Brody?
They were along. A lot of the wrestlers in those days had that certain breed about them. The tenacity, and of course, what everybody wanted to do was to get over. So when you speak of Brody and Scott Irwin, they would always get over. Like I say, you know, tenacity. They were competitors, and
a lot of people don't remember Scott Irwin because he passed early. But he was,
yes, he did. He did. Heartbreaking. Yes,
he was huge. He was in great shape, and he could work.
Yes, he could. Yeah. And he was the first one that I'd seen with the, you know, the superplex off of the ropes and everything. And the way he did that was just phenomenal. And when Scott passed, it was a sad day. And I still stay in contact with Bill Irwin.
Go ahead. When you first came into World Class, were they selling out Reunion or was it still on the way up?
They were basically selling out by the time I got there.
Okay.
I got there in about, I'm going to say late 82 or mid 82, and then the 82, 83, 84, 85 was just mind-boggling. It just went on and on.
Were you there, you were there a little bit after the Freebirds and the Von Erichs had started their
Yes. The groundwork had been laid, and everything was on its way up. And they'd had switched bookers. You know, the late Gary Hart was there for a while, and then Ken Mantell came in, and then everything else was just, like I said, you know, you had a different package on the card, not only the Von Erichs, you had Chris Adams who had come into the territory, Iceman King Parsons, I'm talking about the baby faces now, and then you had the big dragons like my boys, and then the birds. You know, interestingly, you know, I'd like to add this. There was some times that they would put a six-man on with the Freebirds and Devastation, and we made them big baby faces. Hey, we did that in Dallas and Fort Worth, and they would turn around on the same tape if we were tapings and work with Von Erichs, and their heat was back. But everybody was a baby face with Devastation. You know, we had some tough-looking guys, and you know, the way Akbar always operated, it was like a very serious nature, and I took this business serious, and that's why I maintain heat even till this day.
Well, so. Skandor, I've spoken with a lot of people, Buck Robley, Killer Carl Cox,
yeah,
many others, and they all say that it's underestimated the amount of heat that Skandor Akbar had in Texas and in Mid-South. The fans genuinely, as a character, hated you.
Absolutely.
How'd you get that over?
Well, like I said, just maintaining the character. And, of course, you know, being of Middle Eastern descent, you know, it's kind of like a genuine character. And the thing is, they've blamed me for everything that's happened in the Middle East for the last 50 years, I guess. But, you know, the timing was right. Everything was right. But I always maintained that seriousness when I would leave the arena. under security with my boys. I never cursed back. I ignored them, and that made everybody just as they were all. It was really upsetting, and in those days, the last days of this, you know, the Sportatorium, they would mob out there till 12:30 or 1, well after the matches were ended, and the security would have to take us out. And as I said before, it was a tremendous package with myself and the birds. But I always had that tremendous heat, you know, and going back, and of course over in Mid-South we were on world class, I know, and you know, I had to wear a bulletproof vest in New Orleans at one time. We'll get into that sometimes.
Skandor.
Yes, sir.
You were unpopular with the fans, but behind the scenes, everyone says that they loved you.
Well, I always tried to get along. Gary, there wasn't a territory that I never worked that I couldn't go back to. And even the early days, you know, in the early days, I was bigger than usual, and I was not only a good wrestler, I was a power lifter, and hey, got experience in my early days, you know, I would have to slide over somebody who wasn't in shape and everything, but you know what, I did all that, but I could always go back. And they'd say, anytime you're ready, if you want to come in, come on in. So it was a good feeling. But I worked hard, and I realized that one of the main streams of this business was learning how to interview and talk. And I practiced that by myself for a long time. And when I got the opportunity to do it, that has given me great longevity in this business. You know, my interviews.
Yes. Now, I want to ask you about Fritz von Erich. I've spoken with a lot of people about Fritz.
Yeah.
You had a lot of access to Fritz. He really cared for you.
Yes, he did.
Before things started to happen to the boys, what was Fritz like?
As time went by, when things were going good, Fritz would only come around the office maybe once or twice a week, maybe once a week, but... at that time, I could see that he really wanted to kind of slide out and give the business to the boys. Well, you had some factors there. You had David von Erich, who had a good mind, and he was probably the only one that had left Dallas for a year and worked down in Florida. And David was probably mechanically the best guy in that ring. Of the boys. Now, they were all great athletes. Mike never wanted the business that much, but Kevin and Kerry were magnificent athletes. But David was the guy, and I think Fritz really wanted to get out about that time.
Did he tell you that?
Yeah, in so many words, you know, and you know he'd always kid around. Well, oh, I'm tired, you know. He had that voice and everything, and he said it's about time to turn the reins over. He had made that statement several times.
But Skandor, he had worked in Texas for a long time. It was a good promotion, not a great promotion as far as you know what had happened to World Class. Was he excited about World Class growing, or did he want it, like you said, to grow through the kids?
Well, I think it was growing through the kids, and I think he realized times were going to change somewhat, but he wanted to solidify a powerful organization, and when they came up with this World Class, he wanted to break away from the NWA. Well, you know, he was a charter member at that time, but NWA has started to slide about that time. You know, Gagne had his own deal, and New York had their deal, so they wanted a world class heavyweight champion, and of course they still used NWA. You know, the deal with Race and with Flair and some of the boys. But I think he wanted World Class and the creation to substantiate power and to really to build something that people will remember, and my goodness, they have.
Now, I interviewed Mark Lawrence.
Yeah.
And Mark came up with something that I really hadn't heard before, and that was that if David had lived, if he hadn't died in Japan, that the wrestling landscape today would be very, very different. And what Mark was saying was that David would have taken over the promotion and moved it to places that Fritz just wasn't willing to. Did you know about that at the time?
Yes, I did, and I thoroughly agree with Mark. Most everybody that was there behind the scenes or even working in world class at that time, they will all tell you the same thing. You know, I said earlier about David, he was the man, and he wanted the office. I mean, that was the plans before the untimely death. And later on, Chris had approached Kevin. Kevin never wanted it. I don't know where he was coming from or anything like that, but, you know, I would always hear people say, my God, I'd give my right arm to be one of those guys to take this territory over. That's when things were great. And it was a huge bubble, you know, and I remember the old-timers all told me when I came to business, you know, it's a big bubble, don't burst it. Things can happen, but, you know, in the later days when the slide came, well, even the Von Erich name didn't mean that much. It does mean that much, but, you know, you have to offer the people something else also, even concerning those guys. Well, I didn't want to get off of that, but, yes, I believe if David had lived, things would have been tremendously different, tremendously.
What was the reaction of Fritz after the death of David? Not obviously heartbroken, distraught, but could you see something else evolving, like, hey, who's going to take this thing over for me?
Yes. I think so. I think he was searching then, and he's surrounded by good minds and everything, but when David died, he wanted somebody to, they wanted another Von Erich. So, Mike, this is where Mike came along. You know, he favored David a little bit more than he did the other boys. And Mike really didn't want this business. And his first match, I volunteered to get back in the ring on that. And, you know, it's on that Faded Glory that floating around the country that they did on the family. And he was very, very comfortable with this. And but, you know, he told me, he said, Aggie Akbar, they always call me Aggie. He said, I really didn't want this. He was a musician. That was his first love in life. But I think that Fritz just put that pressure. And, of course, you know what kind of ending that had. But, yeah, I saw a little change after that, and I really thought that, Fritz, that's when I really, really, I think he really wanted to get out. But, you know, it was something that, and they and Andre the Giant loved to come there, and it was a great territory. Everybody was making money, and of course, we had different packages. You know, we mentioned the boys. Hey, Chino Hernandez was in there. Chris Adams was in there. Like I said, Iceman King Parsons and my guys. And Jimmy Garvin, you know, he was kind of like one of the Free Birds and stuff like that. So we had a package that the people just loved. And I'm sure that Fritz believed in his own mind that this thing could go on. He said, but I'm going to kind of turn it over, and, you know, he wanted the boys to have it.
Now, I've heard Gary Hart, before his passing, say many times that he tried to convince Fritz to take the promotion national because, of course, if you went into other big cities, you could draw huge houses, a lot of money would come into the company, and then you could get more talent and things would start to evolve. Do you remember Gary talking to Fritz?
I knew of that. I knew of that. You know, while we're on the subject of Gary, I'd like to add, in March of last year, we went to Allentown, Pennsylvania. He and I and Bill Irwin were the only ones there for a signing in Mid-South. And on the way back, Gary and I rode back together. And, of course, we live in this area. and we said goodbye, and he passed away 8 hours earlier. I couldn't believe it. So Gary had, yes, he did say that. And I'm sure other people did too. Maybe Bronco Lubitsch said that, because Andre would come in and he was being booked by McMahon, you know, the elder Mr. McMahon, who I worked for. And he would say, he said, someday, he said, you'd go nationally, because he said the East Coast is going to do it. When the elder man dies, the elder McMahon, this man will go nationally. So, of course, this came to be. But you know, I don't really think Fritz knew anything. I heard him make the statement a lot of times. He said, "Nobody will ever be in Dallas but me. Nobody." But
did you see Gary confront Fritz on this?
I did not.
Okay.
But, you know, Gary, I knew Gary pretty well, you know, and I met Gary first in 1966, and I was swinging around from territories. I was out there in Amarillo when Dory Funk Sr. was running. I went through there for a short time, and Gary was there, and so I knew him, and I knew when he came back here that he had a good deal. But I did know that because he had told me about that.
What did he say to you behind the scenes in the early 80s? Did he say, "I can't get through to Fritz, I can't get through to Fritz"?
Of course. Yeah. He said he's headstrong and I can't do anything about it. But he wanted, and that's what they really wanted to do, is go national. And, of course, then it became a trend, you know, when Crockett bought out Mid-South, they went this way and this. And but I think that Fritz really believed that this was his little domain, and it was. It was. You know, at that time, nobody could. And it took opposition. I mean, I'm going to say opposition, but like New York, they had took them a long time to crack Dallas, you know, and also in Louisiana. But getting back to Fritz, he was headstrong about that. He did not, and he did bang that fist. He said, "Nobody's going to run Dallas but me," and that voice. And so he believed that. He believed that. Unfortunately, with David gone, I don't think that Kevin had it in his mind, and Kerry didn't, and Mike surely didn't. So then the domino effect became predominant with the boys.
Skandor, what did you think at the time?
Well, I thought I could feel the business would change. Now, see, Gary, I got in a long time ago when nobody stepped on anybody's toes. In other words, an example, the book and I, you know, the two offices in Amarillo would not run close to Dallas, and Dallas would not run close to Lubbock and Amarillo. So everybody around the country had the understanding that there's no opposition, nobody steps on anybody's toes, or so to speak, and that was still going when we got into Dallas at that time, but there was rumors that that was going to change.
But Skandor, you have to remember, and as I'm sure you do, that Fritz was already in some way stepping on other people's toes, because the show was going into the East Coast, it was going in all over the country, and the show that you guys were producing was so far superior to the other local shows.
That's right.
That you guys were already elevating yourself. That's the part of this story I haven't been able to really uncover yet, is why Fritz was so willing to syndicate the show, but wouldn't follow it up with something that would make him the money.
Well, he had the opportunity. He was on Channel 11, which is an independent. It was Gaylord Independent, and it went out through several states. And later on, Fox, it became a CBS affiliate. And the shares, Fritz had a 26 shares there at times on this Channel 11, which is unheard of. And you know, I've talked to people over there at CBS affiliate. They've had pro football, pro basketball, everything, and they've never even come close to what we did on that Saturday night. But he had that opportunity to get on there. And, of course, you know, here goes the Turner Network, too. They had the opportunity also. But we could go to St. Louis. We could go everywhere that Channel 11 came into. And I'll tell you what, we'd go in those different territories and everything would just balloon. I mean, the sellout was there.
For the other promoters?
Yes.
Yeah, because you guys, they'd see you guys up on the Superstation. They'd see you on the Pat Robertson's network. Then you'd go in and work St. Louis, and St. Louis would get a boost because the local fans wanted to come out and see you guys, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. Yes, that really happened, particularly in St. Louis. And that's another story I'll get into. Like I said, we had a lot of good guys come in. And Chris Adams came, and he was up and down the card a lot, and then Kamala came in, and everybody that wrestled with Kamala right here in my hometown. Of course, I was in Tulsa that night helping DiBiase turn bad. But they had a spot show. We called spot shows, and when Kamala came in, everybody did a 15-second you-know-what, because he was so tenacious and everything, so... Chris Adams had came to the promotion, and he told him, he said, if I had a place to go, I'd leave now. I'm dead. They said, it doesn't work that way. And Bronco, the late Bronco Lubitsch, who I respected so much, told him, he said, no, 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 this is not the end. So they had Sunshine here. Remember Sunshine with Jimmy Garvin? She had a lot of heat on her. So Jimmy Garvin's wife was coming back to the organization. They were just going to dump Sunshine. So Ken Mantell came up with the idea, and a bunch of guys there, Bronco, he said, why don't we turn her good? She's a baby face. So they did that over a period of several weeks, and it got over good. But they were wondering, who are we going to put with? David's wife was jealous. Carrie's wife was jealous. It went on and on, Kevin. So they said, how about Chris Adams? And Chris Adams never looked back. He went with Sunshine and Chris against Jimmy Garvin and Precious in St. Louis and sold it out. True story. So, you know, it just goes to show you how powerful everything was.
Now, in 1984, Vince goes national, and Fritz finally opens the doors and says, okay, we're going to go outside the territory. And I remember he came into Lynn, Massachusetts. Were you at that show?
I was not there.
Okay.
I was still working back and forth in 84, and I believe I was in over in Mid-South.
Did you hear anything why Fritz
allowed? Well, I think they liked what had happened, but I never heard much comment on that. I don't know if really wasn't his cup of tea, but he wanted to do it.
Okay. Who was pushing more to go national, Ken Mantell or Gary Hart?
I think Gary Hart, but now Ken Mantell was in syndicating. We had a syndicator out here at Las Colinas here in Dallas. And he's the one that really started the ball rolling. Ken is the one that started the Superstation and the idea of World Class expanding out. So we had a syndicator that got those things done. And, of course, it was interesting anywhere you went. And there was but I still think Fritz had his mind. He said, I'm just not going to get too far away from Dallas. I'm going to come back. And, like I say, everything was just so lucrative here. It was just unbelievable. But, you know, other places too. And I think if they'd concentrated more on the outside, that would have helped also.
Now, as World Class began to unwind, it became obvious that some of the boys, or maybe even most of the boys within the company, had issues with drugs. Were you worried about that as a concern?
Oh yes, yes. Of course, we were all worried about that. And yes, and truly, we knew it was going on.
Was it hidden abuse, or was it just right there in the dressing room?
Well, not so much in the dressing room. But when they came in, you could tell, and, you know, it was running rampant. The business was changing a little bit about that. You know, when I got into the business, the guys might enjoy a little six-pack of beer, but nobody missed a shot, and there was no weed or drugs or narcotics or anything like that. And, you know, it became a primary concern. It became a big concern, And that's when the boys started missing shots. And
so, Skandor, you're in the dressing room. You're old school. You don't miss shots.
No.
And you're waiting for them to come through the door, and they don't. What? Now, you're not the kind of guy to be outspoken, but what are you thinking? This is just not good.
No. You're exactly right. You're exactly right. You know, and if I was confronted with it or something, I would more or less, offer something. And but I could see it slipping away, and a lot of places. Now, Dallas did not institute this. Would fine guys for being late, but maybe they should have, because there's nothing, and I've done some private promotions too. There's nothing that gives somebody an ulcerated stomach wound as to the fact that somebody's going to the show, and the substitutions hurt you more in wrestling than anything in the world, and they still do on these little independents sometimes. If they want to see somebody, they want to see them. So.
I don't want to talk Mid-South, but I will make this comment, and that is that a lot of people have been critical about Bill Watts.
Yep.
For the way he ran things behind the scenes. Bill Watts wouldn't have stood for the Von Erichs no-shows.
No. See, they think Bill was a tyrant, but let me tell you, Bill did what he had to do because he saw the changes coming too, and missing shots, and he fined them all, no matter who. And it kind of got their attention. But here it wasn't, and it should have been. It should have been, but unfortunately, it wasn't. Now, we brought the Von Erichs up to Mid-South, too, a lot, and I'll get into that a little later on. But, Bill, he wasn't a tyrant at all. I mean, he ran the business the way that he should have at that point in time. But in getting back to the national deal, it was when we started going, and the ratings were just tremendous here. They were just out of sight, and everywhere that that we had gone, and everything, you could go in there and of course sell out. But Fritz just never followed up on the shows outside of Dallas that much.
Talk to me a little bit about the Sportatorium. As a TV watcher back then, it looked like this beautiful building, but everyone I've spoken with has said that it was not only not beautiful, but virtual, almost dangerous.
Well, it was. As time went by, it was out of code. Now, they have here what they call grandfather clause. Example, if you have an old garage that's kind of messed up and on closer to somebody else's property, if it was built before 1950 or something, they can't do anything about it. Well, the Sportatorium was leased. Now, Fritz did not own the Sportatorium. Contrary to a lot of belief, he didn't. It was the refrigeration company, Mr. Alford, in the later days that owned it, even when Ed McLemore was there. And they leased it, and the wiring, the plumbing was atrocious. But nobody said anything. And then when we started selling out, the fire marshals and Fritz knew each other, and they let us get by with a lot of things, but it got to the point where it was so many people that the fire marshal had to stop in. But, the code on that building, and after this all came about, and people in the 90s wanted to do the Sportatorium, and it would take like for over a quarter of a million to even recode it. They would have to dig up all that plumbing and everything. So, consequently, the later landlords had torn it down. And a lot of us had the Sportatorium. We wanted the Dallas people to make a historical marker. Now, see, they could have made a museum because of the not only the great wrestling, but Elvis Presley, more or less. He didn't start here, but I mean, he was just a punk kid that had to find a drummer around town to back up his band, and they had the big D Jamboree, had all these people, and it could have paid for itself. But Dallas is funny. If it had been a library, I guess they'd done it. But the Sportatorium, when I was in a lot of countries, of course, and when you go through there and your passport, Dallas, they knew about the Sportatorium. It was worldwide. And I'll say this, anybody that's been anything in this business, most all have walked through those portals. They walked through those doors at the Sportatorium.
Skandor, as things started to disintegrate,
yes.
What was the attitude like in the locker room? Obviously, Fritz had lightning in the bottle with World Class, the Freebirds, the Von Erichs, Chris Adams, Devastation Incorporated.
Yes.
And now it's starting to slip away. And when things start to slip away, very difficult to recover.
Yes. Yes, yes, it is. Yes, it is. No matter how many times and how popular you are and how over, so to speak, the thing about it is, people eventually become despondent about it. They don't like it. They love those kids, the franchise. They loved what was going on. But, you know, you it's almost like the old proverbial thing where you ride the horse the cliff, but it won't go over. But those things begin to happen, like 85, 86. Things were still good, but the people, you know, were beginning to absorb the rumors about the kids and the drugs and what was going on.
And then the death of Gino Hernandez.
Very bad.
Very,
yes, yeah,
very
yeah.
bad, yeah.
Yes, yes. And, you know, that was...
I think people focus on the Von Erich deaths.
Yeah.
But Gino had just had that successful program with Chris as a partner against the Von Erichs. They 30,000, 35,000 people in the Cotton Bowl.
Mm-hmm.
The promotion was still hanging in there. Gino dies, and people start to look at this and say, whoa, wait a minute.
That's true. It was tragic about Gino and all the boys. But if you'll look back, and, you know, some people, I had an interview not long ago, and this guy said, what about the Sportatorium curse? And I said, what do you mean? And then, of course, he named off, done a lot of research on this, so many in the modern era that have died that worked in the Sportatorium. It was uncanny. I couldn't believe. And when you start saying that, you know, the Von Erichs, you got Gino, even Rick Rude worked here. He died. Brody was here. He's gone. I mean, it was like 16 or 18 guys. And, you know, that's unheard of.
Well, you make a good point in that, you know, drugs and wrestling are, they go together in modern day, even today.
But my goodness, yeah.
But people focus on the drugs in World Class, and some people might not believe in a jinx, but others might.
Yes, yes. Yeah, that's right. That's right. You're absolutely. It's kind of like, hold on just 1 minute.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just switched around here just
yeah,
a little
no problem.
While. But I know it goes on now. We had dress codes, and even the big organizations, they come in the dressing room with flip-flops and what have you and stuff like that, and tank tops and stuff like that, and it's kind of like they look like they come out of the gym, you know?
Yeah.
Are we getting a bleed over?
I wasn't going to say anything, but we are getting a bleed over, and it can't be for me.
Huh?
It's got to be on your end.
It has, yeah. Hold on, let me get back on this little one here.
Okay.
Now, if this cuts off, it'll be all right,
okay,
so I'll get back.
Yep.
Okay?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hold on.
Go ahead. Oh, boy. Little technical issues here. Ah, there you go.
Okay, we got it?
Yeah, that's better. No bleed over.
Okay. Can you hear me better now?
Yeah, I can hear you good.
Hello?
Skandor?
Hello?
Hello, I'm here. You're faint.
Hello?
Yeah, now we're back to bleed over.
Okay, I'm sorry. Are you okay now? Now I'll hang this one up here. Okay.
Okay, that's what's doing.
Okay, got it.
I'll edit this out.
Yeah.
Don't worry. Let me write this down. Edit. Okay, 3, 2, 1.
Uh-huh.
Go ahead.
Okay. So, we were on the subject about the changes, and it did have a diverse effect. And later on, when the Sportatorium had started the big slide and everything, and I guess the kids were, you know, after everything happened with the kids and everything, I think it was like Fritz wanted out, and he finally eventually did, and they sold Ken Mantell.
Skandor, were you around when the crowds were slipping, or did you take off to Mid-South?
No, I went back to Mid-South in those days, and of course, now I would come in for the big shows. I came in for Texas Stadium, the Cotton Bowl, and I worked several of those. I never really out there. Was one Texas Stadium that I missed.
Were you there when the Texas Stadium was virtually empty in the 80? I think it was 87.
Yeah, I was one. I was one of the last ones, incidentally.
What's that like in a huge stadium like that with only 6,000 or 7,000 fans? Does it feel strange, or it's no difference, or?
Well,
do you remember?
Yeah, there is a difference. There is a difference, but when you're out there, you just concentrate on what's going on. But, you know, we did the Cotton Bowl down here, and then we did Fort Worth, Tarrant County Convention Center, the big ones, and they all begin to go by the wayside. They surely did.
Did Fritz ever come in and, you know, I've heard he took his fist and smashed on the table, and we're going to clean this thing up, or you didn't see that?
Never saw it again.
Never saw it.
Never saw it again. I think he was just trying to pass the reins on, and
there was nobody to pass them on to.
No, no. But he had good people in the office. Bronco was there, and there were several people.
Did you know anything about Kerry's accident? As far as there was a lot of stuff going on behind the scenes. Obviously, he got in the motorcycle accident. Did you have any insight into that at the time?
Well, I got it from a reliable source about the accident. He had the accident, but he tried to, when he was supposed to be resting the accident, he was resting. He re-injured it on the motorcycle. And contrary to the belief, you know, the entire ankle was not amputated. There was a like a stump there, and I was one of the very few to see it. You know, he'd always covered up and never shower or anything like that. So,
Kerry was a proud guy. It must have.
He was a proud guy. You know, Gary kept on, and he became addicted to pain pills. But you know what? That was the only way he could go. And I've talked to other people that were amputees, and they chose to amputate the leg because when there's something like that that happens, then the excruciating pain becomes so unbearable, and that's what really happened to Kerry.
Yeah.
And the loss of his family, as far as divorce-wise, the two little beautiful little children that he has, I think it just kind of took its toll on him. And I will tell you another thing about Fritz, too. He had been out of the business for a while. He had stayed home, and when Kerry did this thing, he had called me that day, and it was in February, and I told him, I said, why don't you come down to the sportatorium? I'd love, you know, and he said, well, okay, I'll get that claw on you. Yeah, he always does that. And about 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Bronco Lubitsch calls and says, you're not going to believe this. Said Kerry killed himself, and I said, I just got through talking to Fritz. I hadn't talked to him since Christmas. What's going on? He said, well, it happened. Then we were devastated. And at that time, a different promotion had taken over, but Kerry had come back and worked with us. And there was a local lawyer here in town that had got into the Mid-South deal, and the World Class. And we were doing all right. We did a little deal for Kerry. But in the last days, Kerry came back, and he and I became closer, and we were doing the more or less the manipulation and everything here. And he fit in so good again, and he was. I think he had aspirations of going back to his marriage, but I do not think that that would ever transpire. As a matter of fact, as it goes in saying that he met with her that day, and she declined. You know, the reconciliation, so he goes to Fritz's, and the way Fritz told me that he went out to the pasture. When he didn't come back, he knew what had happened. So, you know, though that's a very tragic thing, and I really think that you just put the cap on Fritz, and I think, I'm sorry, on Fritz, because you know, Fritz died in 97, and I think he was either 93 or 94 when Carrie passed away. Then, you know, Fritz and Doris divorced and everything. And
did you ever speak with Fritz at length after that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What,
yeah.
What was he? I've read his autobiography, and he started to become have questions about the existence of God, as, you know, losing all those sons. It's not hard to understand. What was his mindset at that? That's just devastating to lose those boys.
Well, this lawyer that was in the sportatorium with my, you know, with us, and we went out to visit him, and before we did the Carey tribute to make sure everything was all right, and he agreed. He came down there for the tribute and everything, so we wanted to make sure and get everything right, and he dwelled on it and everything, and he said, this will be the last hurrah, the last anybody will ever see me. He said, but I will come out there for the Carey tribute. So he was very despondent. You know, I had never seen him like that. I mean, he would always had tenacity he always had and everything, but Fritz was almost subdued when I saw him that last time. And I spoke to him about a week or two before he died. He was up at Baylor. So it was...
Obviously, he had a lot of regrets.
Yes, he did.
And maybe some confusion, because sometimes, you know, you can control yourself to some extent, but everybody's got a free will, and you know.
Well, it's like, why? You know, it's a three-letter word, but, you know, when people get a terminal disease, they'll say, why me? Well, Fritz Feth, you know, why me, the boys? And how many American families do we know about that lost as many people as that family lost, as many people that reside in this country? You know, it's really hard to fathom, because it just doesn't happen every day. And it really tore him down. Yeah, he was really subdued when I saw him and then talked to him on the phone.
How do you explain Kevin making it through all this? Because Kevin must have had issues as well, and he just escaped. They really should almost make a movie about it.
Well, they started. I believe that it was in the works, but Kevin got away. And about a couple of 3 years ago, I got Kevin to come up to Paris, Texas, to make a little appearance, but he was strictly against that. He was strictly against that, but he did it, and he doesn't like to be around the arena. And Pam doesn't want it either, his wife, because, you know, Kevin gets down a lot about that.
Yeah.
And they live over in Hawaii now and everything, and I talked to him not long ago, but no, he does not. He doesn't want to do that. He doesn't want to do that.
Very difficult.
Yes.
Ken Mantell comes into Texas 1987, 88. He had been running a Wild West wrestling.
Yes.
And World Class has a little bit of a revitalization. Michael Hayes is back in. Iceman. It's starting to look good, but the crowd's still not there, right?
No. When that happened, I went back to Mid-South, which became UWF for a short time. And I talked to Ken about it, but I figured the best thing for me to go. And I said, well, I will come back at a later date. But Kenny had that Wild West wrestling, and he was successful in syndicating that out for a while. But it just wasn't the same. You know, when you look for the encore, it just wasn't the same as the days. I don't think they ever recaptured that. Never, never.
And then something even more interesting happens in that Jerry Jarrett purchases World Class from Fritz.
Now, I worked with Jerry Jarrett down there finally.
And again a revitalization, and again it leads to the death, which I never quite understood why it died. But talk a little bit about Jarrett in Texas.
Well, when Jarrett got in, he got in and paid back stuff that they owed Channel 11 after Fritz got in, and the kids were still somewhat partners. Jarrett got in the... the Sportatorium, and I met with him and everything. We worked with him, and we started drawing some good crowds, but it was a Band-Aid operation financially and everything like that. You know, Jerry, he always watched his dollars, I guess, like everybody else. But I had a kid here named Eric Embry that helped out a lot, and we did a deal with Eric Embry that everybody said couldn't be done. We turned him babyface. Now, he had the gay gimmick and the sourdough body and everything like that, and they said, you never can do it. So we went out and Devastation, and we made a big, big, and I'm telling you, big babyface out of that guy. And he started getting letters again. It was almost like revitalizing world class. He started getting the letters, and the postman was always saying, my God, that's as many letters as we've got in a long time. But you could do anything with television. You could do anything with TV. We still had TV then. You had to remember that, you know, Channel 11.
Didn't Jarrett have an ability of taking somebody who almost didn't belong in the ring at all and making them a usable main eventer?
More or less he did. Yes, more or less he did. The one thing I can say about Jerry Jarrett, I admire him because his son did not start out on top, you know. You know, he paid a few dues over there before that, he started a spotlight, Jeff. But eventually Jerry became despondent, and there was a lawsuit involved, too. Kevin's lawyers... they started to intervene because some way that Jarrett had made a mistake. I don't know the details on that, but that's when Jerry started to fade away. And when he got out, then several other promotions tried to take it.
Excuse me, Skandor, were you there as he was going out?
Yes, yes.
Because I used to watch on Saturday nights, Channel 11. It was broadcast all over the country on satellite and cable.
Mm-hmm.
And USWA, which World Class evolved into, there was interest at the Sportatorium, and then it just kind of vanished, and it happened quickly. What was going on behind the scenes?
Well, he was he had put a lot of effort in it, not a lot of money, but effort, and you need to change out talent just a little bit too. So that was an issue there that he didn't want it to, and he still had Memphis or whatever. And then after this thing happened with Kerry and Embry and everything, then the people started, it wasn't drawing like it used to be. And so he wanted to get out.
Was Jarrett notorious in the locker room for underpaying the guys?
Oh, gosh, yeah, somewhat, yeah. Yeah,
because Mark Lawrence said that the reason he finally left was because Jarrett just told him, we're slashing your pay in half, and Mark didn't want any part of it, and he left. And Mark was a very important part of the presentation at the time.
Mm-hmm.
So, and a lot of people said that about Jarrett, which, you know, a good businessman is going to try and keep a bottom line and make a profit. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. Right. Well, those things happened, you know, and then... There were
some revival attempts after Jarrett left.
Yeah, there was a small outfit. Grizzly Smith and I helped them out a little bit, and they call themselves Confederate Wrestling Association for a while, with a little money in it, but not big. So, you know, those things didn't work out and everything the way they should have.
What's the one moment, Skandor, you look back at and say, aside from the death of David... This is where we lost it. In Texas. This is where the fans, we lost our connection with the fans, aside from David's death.
Well, more or less. They were still with us when David's death. But, it did lead to the trail of demise. It really did.
Do you think it was a booking problem or the out-of-the-ring problems?
I think it was out-of-the-ring problem. I really do.
Yeah.
I really do, because people begin to you know, they started to grasp that. They really did.
Do you miss it, Skandor?
Oh, yes. Yes, yeah, I love the business, and I wouldn't trade any moment for it, you know, and I was an intricate part of a lot of things.
Do you look back at World Class like Gary Hart and say, you know, I really wish these guys had their act together because I would have had a much longer run within the company?
Right. Oh, yes. Yes, Yes, indeed. And believe me, and I'll say this right now, that after World Class, all the attempts were made, and that included Jarrett and the other people, never had an encore. Because what do you do for an encore when you had those tremendous years? What do you do? I mean, what can you do? So it was there. It was gone. And, you know, that bubble burst, like I had mentioned before, and that's it. It's gone. It's like a page torn out. But I'll say it again. They've reached epic proportions with that. It was unbelievable how popular that it was, and wherever we went.
Were there points when you were at ringside and you looked out and you saw the people and you, I just can't believe this, during the glory days?
Oh yes, yeah.
Or did you get caught up in it?
Well, I really, you know, it was. I knew that things were good, you know, because I'd been around the business a long time, and you know, I could feel it. You know, you can feel when things are everything is getting over. You can feel that. So it was an experience that I really, really, I am so thankful that I was part of. And I loved every bit of it. And, you know, as far as the family, Fritz, Jack and his family and everything, they were just, they'll always be in the best memories. And, you know, when the funerals came around, I couldn't go. I had so much heat. There was no way. But I offer my condolences to the family, you know, privately. But there was no way. There was no way I could go. And neither could the birds. I don't think they ever went either, you know. But it was an experience that, you know, I had a friend of mine retired from a bank over here in Third. Oh.
Yes.
Are you there?
Yeah.
And he said it was so uneventful. And I said, well, sir, I wouldn't take 1 week's bad bookings for all that 30 years you had in that bank. So it was great. It was great. Okay. There's a KRLD tower that's out here, you know, and it bleeds over sometime in this back over. But I'm okay. You know, if you want to go on, we can go on. And I'd love to do the Mid-South whenever.
You like the interview?
I loved it.
Okay. We're going to close this up because we're going to do an hour, and then we'll – don't hang up on me, though, okay?
Okay, we're going to close up this one for now,
we're
right?
We're going to close this one, but don't hang up. I'm going to say thank you nice and blah, 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 blah. But you don't hang up because I still want to talk to you for just a second. Okay?
Surely.
Three, two, one. Skandor, I'd just like to thank you for taking the time with us today, the secrets, the behind-the-scenes happenings at World Class. And you were a great part of it. I really enjoyed the way you handled yourself inside the ring and as the manager, the creator of Devastation Incorporated.
Well, I certainly appreciate that, Gary. And, you know, it was so fortunate for me to be part of it. And it was an era in wrestling and professional wrestling the way it was. And it was something that people remembered, etched in their mind. How many people, as I said before earlier, that would stop me on the street and ask me about world-class wrestling. They just, you know, they just loved it. They loved every minute of it, and I loved every minute also. And it's always been a pleasure for me to talk about it because, you know, you love to talk about good things that happen in your life. Everybody's like that. And that was one of the high points of Skandor Akbar's career. And like I say, it spanned from 1961 on up to private.
Skandor, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Talk to you soon.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.